Welcome back to Let's Play Cayne, blind, so we don't get killed. Into the brain emulation lab. Hello?
Hadley, my dearest little girl, my sweet creature. You're alive.
Oh, that's the voice that we've been talking to?
Know you. Oh, my girl.
What the hell's that?
I know you better than you know yourself right now.
What?
Adams will suffice.
Well, that's Adams.
You need to go.
No.
Well, that's the other, and not the voice.
Here's the masterpiece inside of you. Healthy, I hope. Growing quickly now, I'm sure. It's nearly time.
What do you mean?
Our baby, Hadley.
Don't talk about my baby. Why did you take me?
You were the right person in the right place at the right time.
Can you help me get out of here?
Trust him.
Out of here? Don't worry about getting out. Security will be here soon. They'll set this all right. Just come. Wait here. This is the safest room in the facility.
Oh,
here.
Sure.
Closer to me.
I don't think so.
Can he hear that voice? Well, I don't... There's some kind of force field. I don't think we can get past here. The plasma ionizes the air and forms an impenetrable hexagonal barrier of energy. Dr. Adams, wheezing obscenely with every breath, he watches Hadley with a smug, sanctimonious sneer. What is with these things that keep bursting out? Small plumes of holographic particles rotate slowly. They indicate that this door is locked. An advanced portable energy field projector. Plastic-covered surgical chair. A series of heavy-duty restraints clamped to the chair suggests its occupants might not have been there entirely of their own volition. That was another chair. Fire suppression foam. Noxious vapors still seep from the glutinous muck. Lacerated flooring panels. The damage has exposed a section of the maintenance system. I guess we can mess with that. A clutter of displaced tiles look like they've been pushed up from below. Sizzling fire. Flames lick at the sides of the surgical apparatus, leaving sooty streaks in the melting plastic. So, what we know is that Dr. Adams, I guess, paid or instructed Joseph Bueno to, I guess, have a one-night stand with Hadley. So this is, Bueno is the father. Hadley is obviously the mother. Isolated fire loiters between the congealing clots of fire suppression foam. So he was, maybe it's done some kind of something to Bueno? To alter him. The private journal has been knocked to the floor. So he's created something. It's obviously not a normal baby, so I guess he's altered Bueno, or altered us, or both. I don't know what that stuff is. Let's look, let's read the PDA for anything else.
I'm afraid Adams. Most of that information may be a little above your head.
I'm tempted to stick around just to see this place burn.
I think we can manage it. Okay, Valentine's Day, February 14th. The day of love. Not that it means much to a senescent bachelor like me, but, oh, an old man can dream, can he not? For old men have nothing but dreams to keep them awake in the sleepy, languorous twilight of their years, one might suppose, and a dream of love is a salve on this chap's unrealized passion, his grief, his regret. My work in the facility is a different matter entirely, however. Cayne has already been delivered to us in stasis, and I still haven't succeeded with even a single subject. A most exasperating problem indeed, not least as this would be only the start of my own ambitions, my own renaissance. Are we supposed to be giving birth to Cayne or something? Cayne's brain inside the infant's body? Maybe it was a normal baby and then he did stuff to us. Dr. Milan's research has demonstrated that consciousness is nothing more than a program, a set of equations and instructions and conditional arguments. It can be replicated and it can be transplanted, but much like the body's immune response may reject a transplanted limb, so the body's most basic neural encoding, its inherent sense of self, or what Freud called the id, may also reject a transplanted consciousness. The question is how to suppress that encoding, how to suppress perhaps the human soul itself. Instead of looking for an answer, instead of solving the predicament of human mortality, I am dreaming of Joseph Brano eating me, and it's rather arousing. What? You're messed up, man. So he's got an oxygen tube attached to him? So maybe you want to transplant the consciousness into a baby's brain. Unless he did want to extract the fetus, sorry. But we interrupted that process. March 4th. Now here's an intriguing coincidence. I've discovered that a recent, but otherwise bureaucratically insignificant, employee in the facility is related to Cayne. The genealogy is tenuous, but definitely established. Definitively established. Maybe Joseph? Well, Sharon's related to Cayne. Could a genetic component be the solution to our problem? Acquisition could be precarious, but a man finds luck where opportunity and preparation meet. And this man could use a bit of luck. I have an opportunity, so now to prepare. April 2nd. Hank is mostly my fault. Oh, Hank. I'm afraid of the calendar, I told him this morning. Why? He asked. Because its days are numbered, I replied. And then I had to explain the joke, because Hank is not exactly the most socially sophisticated boy. He's not exactly the most ordinary boy. I should have disposed of him with his host, I know. But I'm maudlin, and besides, I'd always wanted a child. I'd always wanted to be a dad. I named him after my own late father, a man I confessed I despised for reasons too numerous and humiliating to disclose here. But my colleagues in the lab call him the Hobo. I should probably be insulted on his behalf, but I'm not sure I blame them. He might be a kind of ersatz son, but he is undeniably peculiar. Sorry, I was just drinking something. So Hank is the Hobo. Much like me, since adolescence I've been fascinated, no consumed by the prospect of incorporation, of two people merging, absorbing, and coalescing with each other, and becoming one. It's obviously been a tremendous motivation for my ongoing research at the facility, but it's also profoundly personal. If I could transplant an adult's consciousness within an infant subject, it might be possible, with some recalibration, no doubt, but fundamentally not a dissimilar process in theory to transplant an adult's consciousness with another adult. It would certainly preclude the vulgar, taboo, grisly mess, and dubiously esoteric prospects of old-fashioned cannibalism anyway. And Joseph is the sort of man I always wished I could be. Elegant, charismatic, generously endowed. I mean, I assume he's generously endowed. Okay. So he wants to transplant his consciousness into Joseph. At least at this point. May 23rd. Kern's project is absurd. The regrowth of organs is only a temporary solution to the permanent problem of inevitable infirmity, and a most impractical one. Sooner or later, the body itself must be replaced, whatever his pious pretensions and shrieks of heresy. He can worship Cayne all he wants, but science is, as they say, a non-profit, get it, organization. Cayne is a client, even if he does technically pay our salaries. Our work here is not some occult apostolic devotion. It is legitimate, if maybe not entirely ethical, I'll concede, medical research for the future prosperity of humanity. Definitely unethical. We've seen that in stasis. or the future prosperity of our facility, in Ralph's case. Ha. We're all about maximizing efficiency over here, and we didn't need a health and fitness officer when everybody who works in this lab is already a medical professional. In the meantime, progress on my own special order is exceeding expectations. Joseph has proven rather more resourceful than I'd first imagined, although I'll claim the credit for his, extraordinary virility. I've started contriving arrangements for the host's transfer to my lab within the next 2 months or so, with final delivery scheduled just in time for the ho-ho holidays. Oh, Dr. Adams, for me? You shouldn't have. Okay, he's talking about us. Are we the host? The final delivery. July 10th. We've had a series of accidents in the lab. Actually, I suspect sabotage of some sort. I found some discrepancies in our security access logs, but the joke's on whoever is responsible, because the early termination of our last two host batches has provided a convenient subterfuge for the requisition of my own special order. Now I can watch it on the ultrasound monitor 24 hours a day. All other priorities rescinded. The early termination of our last two host batches. I'm guessing her baby is the special order. December 15th. Reports of an emergency situation elsewhere in the facility, although the details are infuriatingly, if unexpectedly, ambiguous. As per official company protocol, I've started the arduous process of backing up my lab work, but if a full evacuation is called, I could lose the most crucial progress I've made on the subject. Progress which has, in fact, come almost a full term. He's talking about us. What do I have to do with these flooring panels? I've got a fire suppression cylinder.
What's that thing out there?
Samantha, a grotesque violation of genetics. But she is locked away. Joseph managed to lure her behind the loading fence. Quite the action hero, our Joseph. Oh. He did die rather spectacularly.
About that fence.
This has been ripped open, and your experiment is going to tear us all to pieces.
No. All three of us will be safe very soon. Then we can carry on where we left off.
I said don't talk about my baby.
Yeah, three of us. A synthetic hydrocarbon-based high expansion gel. So, why do we want to put out these flames? I don't know if it's these flames that we want to put out. Maybe in the other room, the crew quarters, we can jump over that fence then. Okay, so we still have our data records, an Omni tool, a whip, a PDT, fire suppression cylinder, a picture of Joseph, and a voice recording of Joseph.
Hadley, you can't leave me.
Watch me. I hate coming out here, because I know... Yeah, it's confirmed, Samantha... was the one behind the fence. So let's try the crew facilities, because we might be able to use the... flame suppression canister. To get into the other crew quarters, or at least one other. This is a wannabe DJ or something like that. Smoldering debris. With this. Nice.
Excellent! And I totally knew it was going to do that.
Nothing. I think that's what scares me.
Nothing scares you?
The idea that when we die, there's just nothing.
It's not nothing. Sounds like you have a life most are envious of. You have kids, right? A real family. Like people know you exist. Real life. Some of us never got off the starting line.
You will have a family soon.
When I die, I want to leave something behind. You have that. I have student debt and a goldfish.
Your legacy is the child inside of you.
This baby deserves more than what I could ever give. Deserves to be part of something.
Not sure it's human.
Something bigger than me. Family. A home. A future.
Cindy Milan. I want to get into Cindy Milan's quarters. Alright, so let's check out this PDA. She just decided to come up here of her own volition. Good thing the oxygen didn't make the fire spread even more. It's Joseph's. February 14th, everyone's...
Jerk! What the hell was I thinking?
Oh, so this is when the... Is this when the conception happened? On Valentine's Day. February 14th. I don't even want to know what happened in the lab. Kept a bunch of pregnant bitches locked up in one place long enough and shit's gonna go down. Everybody knows that. But with Cayne arriving next month and now this disaster, security is getting tighter than my glutes on leg day. LOL. Gotta use that line at the interdepartmental mixer later. Between this, my new skincare regime, and that baby, let's make like a DNA helicase and unzip these jeans t-shirt. Those sluts from the organ grinder are gonna be slipping sliding off their seats. Okay. January 23rd. January 23rd. This is out of order. I hit the jackpot. Hit it, but didn't quit it. If you know what I mean. Winky smiley faces. Gotta keep this plate spinning because her name's Julia Kern and she's only, wait for it, Professor Kern's daughter and his assistant. She's a solid 6.8 out of 10, maybe even a 7.1 if she'd shut the hell up. Nice deltoids. More importantly though, she's in charge of Samantha and her grubs. I play this right, I've got free tickets to the organ grinder's petting zoo whenever I want. More like heavy petting zoo. Major threesome potential? LOL. Threesome with who? Samantha? Maybe. But seriously, this is just what you've been waiting for, Brosef. What? I might even get to cop a feel of Samantha. Just thinking about it is getting me so hot. The new batch of hosts is going to feel that burn tomorrow. Have you seen Samantha? Why is this out of order? Then February 12th. Is that pinned to the top? February 14th? February 12th. Got some annoying new guy bothering us in the lab about the facility's new perpetual quantum power system. Danny something or other. Total beta. He's even got a pet bird. Had to sit through a whole presentation about... Shit, I don't know. I don't pay attention to chumps. I was too busy dreaming about the nasty things I'm gonna do with Samantha. Are you kidding? Julia gave me a grand tour around the organ grinder yesterday. I noticed a spare larvae incubation canister in one of the storerooms. We need that. It's a bit busted up, but I think I could fix it. The real problem is liberating some of those grubs. But just imagine I could grow my very own sexy mermaid monster. Maybe I even can put in a requisition to Cayne Tech for an extra office orifice mod. Is it office? Orifice mod, LOL. Yeah, I'm trying to make this less disgusting. My brain is auto-correcting this into something that's, like, more normal. So he wants to do it with monsters. But why, though? He's seen this thing? What? I mean, it's practically bestiality. But according to, what's it, Julia? Does Samantha can talk? She didn't bother talking to us. She just growled. Or roared, or something. In the meantime, though, I've been cooking up a new sedative mix with a lab host that keeps them nice and compliant. But also just a bit awake, you know. What's that? Low enough consciousness to keep the EEG normal, but high enough that they know when I'm working on my special projects. Gotta keep myself busy, you know? The organ grinder spare room. The organ grinder store room. That's where that canister is. We're gonna need that to defend ourselves against Samantha. And so we gotta do something with that force field. Too. I know there's a reason for that. Maybe someone else is gonna chase us other than Samantha, I don't know. Or maybe she'll chase us anyway. I don't know. Maybe we keep her behind the force field long enough to have the grubs affect her? I don't know. March 18th. There's something wrong with the food. I swear, people are shitting out their eyes. I told one of the interns that Danny's been dosing the rations with radioactive goo because screw that guy and his dumbass bird. It's totally the kind of thing a beta loser like him would do for attention anyway. What the hell is up with his cheese diet? Sure enough, everybody was blaming that asshole in about 2 hours. LOL. Managed to grab that larvae incubator and two grubs while everybody else in the lab was cramming the toilets, though. Hello, Grubette and Grublina. Okay, so he has it, or had it. It's quite some time ago, March 18th. April 17th. Adams paid me to hook up with some chick off-site last night. That's, us. He gave me a bunch of performance enhancement pills. Like the sexual Tyrannosaurus needs it, lol. Okay, Predator reference. And I had to get video proof and everything. Oh, God. He was very insistent about that. I didn't know he was into that kinky voyeur shit. Anyway, actually, I kind of thought he was into me. That old creeper eyeballs me, like, constantly. Does that make me some kind of, like, hot wife, but a dude version? Is that gay? Whatever. It's cash in the bank, and Julia won't ever find out. Oh, Julia finds out. So is he related to Cayne? I don't know. Like, we didn't already have enough shit stains around the facility. Cayne has sent us a health and fitness officer to sort out the food problem instead of sending us more food. What the hell are these corporates smoking in the boardroom? Because I could use some of that. July 29th. I don't know what that announcement was. Shit's been crazy. First, the arm malfunctioned in the lab. Don't know what the deal is there, but we've had eggheads coming in and out of all hours trying to fix it, and we lost 2 shipments of hosts. On the one hand, it's pushed us behind schedule, but on the other, the bruises on those whores were starting to show. Now I've got a whole fresh canvas for my art. Winky smiley face. And hey, remember Ralph? Yeah, Ralph's out. Technically, it was kind of decided he'd be more useful as the PDT printer's new CPU, and nobody else was more fit or healthy for the position. LOL, now Ralph's doing some real work for the company, and nobody has to worry about logging their macros and carbs and whatever, and I monitor my own anyway. So Ralph was a real person. They killed him and decided to make him into the CPU of the PDT printer? Somehow? Oh, and somebody found a thing in Atmospherex, like some kind of puppet made of rotting body parts. I'm pretty sure it's the hobo's girlfriend or some shit. LOL. I guess some guys gotta get it where they can. Let's be honest. Who am I to judge? Yeah, I think that's what it is. Last but not least, I think Grublina might be pregnant. Yeah, she's definitely getting fatter, and not just because she ate Grubette. For reals, that is a thing that legit happened. Gnawed at her carcass for like a whole week, and her boobs are getting huge. Grubs have boobs. A little punishment and they spew grub milk everywhere. It's actually kind of hot, but gross, but also hot. What? What the hell is wrong with this guy? This December 12th. Julia is beginning to irritate the shit out of me, since winning a few bruises is not a sign of love. A few. LOL. Chivalry when they like it and sexism when they don't. Smiley faces. With extra chins. Dude, I am totally the new resident DJ in the crew lounge. My sexy tunes are making the bitch hot for a Brosef meetup. Get it? I put my playlist on repeat on the vintage boombox. Pussy magnet. Okay. December 19th. Some kind of emergency drill with the elevator. Don't know what it's about, but it's serious. Ugh. Now somebody's screaming in the corridor. Gotta go, brah. And then you get killed. Just desserts. So I'm guessing this is his quarter. Ripped open door. His quarters, rather. Samantha ripped it open? Because he ran in here and hid.
This room is much smaller than the other.
Maybe he drew the short straw.
This isn't the only small thing he has.
Haha. Speaking from experience. Returning some holodisc by JB, scribbled in the corner. Personal safe. It's a heavy-duty electronic safe with a biometric scanner. Biometric? We're gonna say use his voice in there. Junk. A pile of discarded junk. Nothing stands out as remarkable. Destroyed personal terminal. Whatever might have been useful is wiped out now. What's that? Well, this is out. What's that? Ripped up bed sheets. The reckless disarray suggests somebody was looking for something. Surprised it's not covered in blood. So where did she do it with him? Here? Safe lock. DNA sample required. DNA sample. So this won't work?
Voice playback.
Sit back and relax, and let the Brosef take you to a better place. Can I get a J-O-S-E-P-H?
Voice imprint accepted.
But we need, it needs DNA, it says. So you also gotta get DNA. Could probably get it from anything in his quarters here. A suspect stain in the corner. Maybe that's his DNA. I don't think it's hers, but
DNA accepted.
Okay, it's his. Oh my! Seriously? That's what this thing is. It's not much of a barrier, but it's managed to keep this dirty secret safe. So it's not that we want to get in the safe, it's a whole separate area. That's why this room is smaller than the rest. He has a secret part of his apartment walled off. What the hell?
Oh dear. Can you understand me?
Who is that?
Do you need,
That's the grub.
At a loss for words.
It's a grub. Turn into this. It has breasts. It ate... This is Grublina. Ate Grubette. Oh, good God. Well, this is what we want, an incubation canister. Was it going to attack us? We have to cross it to get there. An empty specimen containment device. Fleshy creature. Its mouth sucks wetly at the stale air, bloated teats heaving ponderously above a clammy, desultory accumulation of limb-like appendages that clatter and scrabble against the metal pen. This is disgusting, you guys. stripped down substructure. Panels have been removed from the walls to maximize space in the cramped annex, exposing dusty insulation and cabling. We can interact with this in some way. So it's held by this whatever this is. Should we whip it? It's an unoccupied specimen containment device with built-in life support and feeding systems. We're gonna whip it. Oh my god.
Oh, come on. I don't have the stomach for this.
We got Grublina milk. Musty gelatinous discharge seeps from its abdominal ducts with each ragged breath. So we're turning on this huge grub thing to make. Oh my god. Where's the milk? A pinkish fluid discharged from Grublina. That's the baited. Oh, the baited canister. Some mammary secretion has been placed inside the incubator. What if we whip it some more? We don't care about doing that. Right. I mean, she might be getting turned on by it. I have no idea.
Maybe if I... Wait, nope.
Yeah, I know.
No. How sickles. Ain't gonna work.
Grimy yellowing mattress. A damp, mildewy stink emanates from the blankets. So did... He's keeping this thing in here to get the milk to... He wanted to pacify Samantha and maybe make his own creature with it? Do we have enough? Do we want to get more of this stuff? I guess we have enough. Alright. I don't mind leaving this place. Okay. This has been very educational. Thanks for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, and always, seek adventure.